What are the prevention and treatment strategies for overtraining syndrome? The primary aim of preventing the development of overtraining syndrome is to avoid excessive training that exceeds the body's ability to recover. This begins with the education of coaches and athletes about the risk factors that may lead to the development of overtraining syndrome. Individualized training regimens. Every athlete has a different stress handling capacity and consequently a different tipping point for progressing to the overreached and overtrained states. Therefore, a training log should be kept for every athlete. This log should contain the measure of rate of perceived exertion or RPE for that particular athlete. Coaches and athletes should use this measure for individual athletes to decide the volume and intensity of exercise for them. Thus, every athlete should have an individualized training prescription. Furthermore, sudden increments in training load should be avoided. The weekly increments should be less than 10%. Early detection of warning signs. Coaches and athletes should be aware of some early signs of overtraining. Firstly, if the athlete is overtrained, there is an increased effort required by the athlete to complete a particular task that he would have completed without the need for increased effort under normal conditions. Furthermore, despite the increased effort, the athlete's performance for that particular task is lower. Thirdly, there is a loss of vigor during training. And finally, the athlete may be able to begin a training session but unable to complete it or give it that finishing kick. Other simple measures that the athletes can use to detect overteaching are weight, morning heart rate and maximal heart rate. Weight measurement can give clues regarding the hydration and nutrition status of the athlete. Morning heart rate can give clues to the function of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Overactivity of the sympathetic nervous system causes the heart rate to be higher, and overactivity of the parasympathetic nervous system causes the heart rate to be lower than normal. Overactivity of the sympathetic nervous system and consequently a higher heart rate is frequently seen in athletes doing weight training. On the contrary, in endurance athletes involved in sports like marathon running, the parasympathetic nervous system is more active and the morning heart rate may be lower. Maximal heart rate can also indicate the status of sympathetic and parasympathetic balance. Questionnaires. Various questionnaires have been developed for the early detection of overreaching and overtraining. Some prominent ones include the Recovery Stress Questionnaire for Athletes, Profile of Mood States or POMS, and the Training Distress Scale. According to the POMS questionnaire, measures like fatigue, loss of vigor, and depression were most commonly associated with overtraining syndrome. Furthermore, a POMS energy index measure, which was a measure derived from POMS to differentiate between fatigue and loss of vigor in overtraining states, found that loss of vigor was more strongly associated with overtraining than fatigue. However, in one study, Training Distress Scale questionnaire outperformed the Profile of Mood States or POMS questionnaire in identifying overtrained swimmers. Nutrition. For the repair and regeneration of muscle, adequate macronutrients like carbohydrates, proteins and fats, and micronutrients like vitamins and minerals are required. Thus, proper nutrition plays an important role in the recovery. Inadequate nutrition can delay the recovery process, and this effect can pile up over a period, eventually leading to the development of overtraining syndrome. One common misconception is that carbohydrates should be avoided in trainers, as it may cause weight gain. However, it is important to note that glycogen, which is a form of carbohydrate, is the main source of energy for the exercising muscle. And chronic glycogen depletion can significantly contribute to muscle fatigue. Thus, optimum amounts, that is, not more and not less, of carbohydrates should be included in the diet of trainers. Hydration. Another factor which is often overlooked is adequate hydration. Dehydration can increase the viscosity of the blood. This can lead to reduced blood circulation of the muscle tissue. Reduced blood circulation of the muscle can contribute to impairment of muscle repair and regeneration. Rest and sleep. Adequate resting periods are required between training sessions for recovery. Sleep is the best form of rest. It is during these resting periods that repair and regeneration of the muscle takes place. However, there is still insufficient scientific data regarding the optimum duration of these periods of rest. Reducing other stressors like work pressure, interpersonal conflicts, illnesses and others. Psychological stressors in the background of excessive exercise are important triggers for the development of overtraining syndrome. In times of increased life stressors like infections, training regimens should be temporarily reduced or halted altogether. This is known as periodization and is a proven intervention for reducing the occurrence of overtraining syndrome. In addition to this, psychological interventions like education in stress management and relaxation techniques should be undertaken under the guidance of a sports psychologist. Too frequent sports competitions should be avoided, as these also add up to the total number of stressors and may take a toll on the athlete's health. To summarize, overtraining is a real possibility in an athlete's career, and if not detected and treated early, can have devastating consequences for the athlete. Muscle damage plays an important role in the development of overtraining syndrome. Athletes most commonly experience increased effort and decreased performance, inability to complete a training session, fatigue, loss of vigor, and other symptoms like depression. It is important to rule out other medical conditions before diagnosing an athlete with overtraining syndrome. Currently, there are no validated tests for the diagnosis of overtraining syndrome, but the two-bout maximal exercise protocol may differentiate the conditions of overreaching and overtraining. Some prevention strategies include education of coaches and athletes about the risk factors and signs and symptoms of overtraining for early detection of this condition, individualized training regimens of athletes based on their individual capacities, avoidance of sudden increments in training load, proper nutrition and hydration, sleep and rest, and management of life stressors. Thanks for listening. Bye.